Hey everyone, Baylor here.
I got the idea to try and highlight some important people for Black History Month, but to do so in a way that highlighted who they were and what they accomplished in an objective fashion. When trying to decide who to spotlight, it occurred to me that the best thing that I could do would be to speak about people in fields that overlap with my own knowledge and experience. But even after narrowing it down to just people in my fields of expertise, and then just people in music, and then just guitarists, once I sat down to compile a list, that list went well over 28 names pretty much immediately. One note when you're watching these videos, please keep in mind that I use TikTok for the easy creation tools, but it does mean that the video quality, the sound quality, and of course the screen orientation were all limited by what TikTok offers. Anyway, here are 56 guitarists, each one important to me. All right, guys, listen, this is a blues riff in B. Watch me for the changes and try to keep up. Charles Edward Anderson Berry. I mean, what's there to say? Without Chuck Berry, there's no Beatles, there's no Beach Boys, there's no Rolling Stones. There might not even be a thing called rock and roll. And since guitar is what I know a bit about, let's talk about guitar. In Chuck Berry's hands, the Gibson ES-350T became his second voice, his counterpoint. And that counterpoint was very often a smartass. I mean, look, after he'd recorded a few singles for Chess, like Maybelline, Roll Over Beethoven, Chuck Berry's first full album, After School Session, it begins with the song School Day, Ring Ring Goes the Bell. So you drop the needle, you hear Chuck Berry for the first time, and what sound do you first hear from his first album? It's 13 augmented chords in a row. And I'm not sure everyone is aware about how much Chuck Berry that they know outside of Johnny B. Goode. As I was playing some of Chuck Berry's music around the house, Emily would pipe in every once in a while and say, "Wow, that's him too." Even you Allman Brothers completists, the original trio sessions that became the Allman Brothers, Duane Allman, JMO, Barry Oakley. One of the songs they recorded was a little boogie tune called No Money Down. That's Chuck Berry. Oh, and the last line from Chuck Berry's song Too Much Monkey Business goes, "Working in a filling station, too many tasks, wipe the windows, check the tires, check the oil, dollar gas." But let me see if I can point you in a direction in Chuck Berry's catalog that's a little bit deeper, stuff that you might not know and you might enjoy. First of all, did you know he played pedal steel? The second song on his first album, it's called Deep Feeling, is him playing pedal steel. It's very expressive. Another one I really like is St. Louis to Liverpool from the album Liverpool Drive. It's a fabulous little instrumental. And did you know he did a funk cover of My Babe in 1975? It's true. Chuck Berry.
Let's try a little experiment right now. If I ask you how many of you could clap out a son clave, how many of you? Some of you? Okay. Now, how many of you could clap a Bo Diddley beat? Congratulations, you now know one of the two fundamental rhythms of Afro-Cuban music and all of its derivatives. Now here's another bit of ethnomusicology for you. Picture the most primitive stringed instrument you can think of. Just two nails, a board, a string, something hollow underneath the string to make it louder, like a gourd or a beer bottle, and then you play it with a knife or a bone or a piece of wood. Well, this has got names all over the world, but in the American South, it's called a diddly bow. Judging by Elias McDaniel's early life, you wouldn't peg him for a rocker. Born in Mississippi to sharecroppers, was inspired by John Lee Hooker to play on street corners as a kid, moved to Chicago, played on the South Side clubs, got signed to Chess Records. From all of that, you'd think we'd be in Blues Week. The obvious difference being, starting with his very first side recorded for Chess Records, Bo Diddley. He had this rhythm where the toms and the maracas were holding the groove against this son clave. It's very Latin-inspired kind of a thing. So now you know where the Who and the Clash got a lot of their inspiration. And I have to say, if this is what you're expecting from Bo Diddley's larger output, let's put it this way. I have had a blast exploring Bo Diddley's catalog through the years. I'm almost tempted not to recommend anything and just let you discover it on its own, Because if you're going into Bo Diddley's larger works thinking it's all going to be this Latin-inspired stuff, you're going to be surprised. But just to get you started, let me point you in a couple of things that you might not expect. Look at Grandma from Where It All Began, 1972. Hot Buttered Blues from The Black Gladiator, 1970. And from his very first album, Bring It to Jerome, Hey Bo Diddley. Being a Zappa fan leads you down some interesting paths. On one hand, Ionization by Edgard Varese. On the other hand, 3 Hours Past Midnight by Johnny Guitar Watson. Originally from Houston, when John Watson Jr. started performing, he used the name Young John Watson. But it was a 1954 movie, Johnny Guitar, that inspired him to change his name. His first singles from the 1950s might be less well known today. They sure left an impact. His first single, Space Guitar, was an instrumental that used a lot of distortion, echo, and effects that wouldn't become popular in guitar circles until many years later. And if you're ever wondering where Steve Miller got the idea, in 1957, Johnny Guitar Watson released a single called Gangster of Love. And what I love about Johnny Guitar Watson's catalog is that when blues and 50s-style R&B started to become less popular, he just completely pivoted. And by the mid-70s, he was something of a funk powerhouse. He released 3 albums in a row. Ain't That a Bitch, Funk Beyond the Call of Duty, and Real Mother for You, that grooved just as hard as anything from the Ohio Players of Cool in the Gang, but had intelligence, had humor, and of course his playing, often with a talk box. And when you first hear Johnny Guitar Watson play, you might think like Frank Zappa did, that the way he was getting these amazing hard percussive sounds was by using a big heavy pick, but he didn't. All of those popping sounds you heard was from him pulling with his fingers. It's said he used to go through 2 sets of strings a night. I can't imagine popping strings that quickly. For recommendations, I could tell you to listen to the stuff he recorded with Zappa, but I want you to hear his guitar playing. So start where Zappa did, 3 Hours Past Midnight. And I also recommend listening to Space Guitar, just as a time capsule for the state of guitar in 1955. But for his funk period, listen to the song Superman Lover from the album Ain't That a Bitch. It's a really, really cool wah guitar solo, and it's probably as greasy as guitar gets. Johnny Guitar Watson. I want to like punk. I really do. I like the philosophy. I like the message. I like the attitude. But for the most part, I don't like the music. I'm sorry. I know this makes me a terrible person. There are a few exceptions, though. The Modern Lovers, Marquee Moon by Television. I can get into those albums. And I have some nostalgic attachment to some of the albums by the Dead Kennedys. But of all the punk and proto-punk stuff out there, the one album that I have the strongest attachment to is For the Whole World to See by Death. And no, my metal friends, not that Death. And I wish I could tell you that I was cool enough to have been listening to Death since back in the day. But the truth of the matter is that a movie came out in 2012 called A Band Called Death, and that's what introduced me to their music. The story of Death kind of starts in 1964, when David Hackney and his brothers Bobby and Dennis watched The Beatles on Ed Sullivan. And then the next day, David found an abandoned guitar and started teaching himself to play. And by the early 70s, they had formed a funk trio called the Rock Fire Funk Express. But when their father died, David Hackney decided to change the band's name to Death because he wanted to reassociate that word. He wanted to make something positive out of something negative. But it was seeing The Who perform live that changed the direction of the band. And the result is what you expect. When you hear Death, you definitely hear a funk band that has been inspired to play louder by The Who. And it kind of rocks. And all through that album, the one album that they made for the whole world to see, David Hackney's playing is powerful and intelligent. His rhythm playing is solid and grounded. His leads are inventive and propulsive. So listen to For the Whole World to See, especially the last song, Politicians in My Eyes. David Hackney. I got into Parliament Funkadelic backwards. I mean, I'm sure I heard some of Parliament Funkadelic's music growing up. I'm sure I knew Flashlight. I'm sure I knew Give Up Funk. But it wasn't until the 1992 album Transmutation by Praxis, which I really love, which caused me to dig into their catalog, owing to the fact that both Bootsy Collins and Bernie Worrell were in that band. So I went to the record store and picked up Maggot Brain. I figured I'd be hearing some early 70s funk stuff. You know, Fat Albert Rotunda, somewhere in there. What I was not prepared for, however, was that the album opens with one of the finest guitar solos in history. For a full 10 minutes, Eddie Hazel plays like his mom just died. It was only years later that I found out that George Clinton said to Eddie Hazel as they were about to record, "Play like your mom just died." Although he's born in Brooklyn, his family moved almost immediately to Plainfield, New Jersey. He was playing guitar young, and by the time he was age 12, he was already really good friends with bassist Bill Nelson. By age 17, Billy Nelson was hired in a local doo-wop group called the Parliaments, headed by George Clinton. And it was Billy Nelson that recommended that they hire Eddie Hazel. So that was the plan originally, right? A trio of Eddie Hazel, Billy Nelson, Tiki Fullwood. That trio was the backing band for the vocal group called the Parliaments. So the backing band got its own name, Funkadelic. And even though Eddie Hazel appears on all of the Parliament Funkadelic recordings throughout the 70s, he was featured less and less. He did do a solo album though, in 1977, called Game, Dames, and Guitar Thangs. Definitely listen to Maggot Brain. If you haven't already, I can't imagine. The other one you need to hear is from 1976, their album Hardcore Jollies. This is the first song on that album called Coming Around the Mountain. Check that one out. And listen to a solo album as well, Game, Dames, and Guitar Thangs. It's got a cover of I Want You, She's So Heavy by the Beatles. Eddie Hazel. The chain of events went something like this. In my junior year of high school, I got Adventures in Radioland by John McLaughlin. That led me to Inner Mounting Flame. That led me to Bitches Brew and In a Silent Way, and that led me to Miles's funk period starting in the mid-70s. And all of those funk recordings, the ones that start with On the Corner, the two that I gravitated towards the most were Agartha and Pangea. The combination of the compositions, the improvisational approach, the sounds, they all came together in my brain in such a way that it opened up new possibilities for what music could be. And of course, it didn't hurt that through it all was Pete Cozy, absolutely setting the place on fire every time he touched his guitar. In the late 60s, Pete Cozy was hired as a session musician for Chess Records. Rescue Me, Fontella Bass, that's him. Muddy Waters, Electric Mud, Howlin' Wolf's, the Howlin' Wolf album, that's him. Then came the monster four albums for Miles. Get Up With It, Dark Magus, Agartha, Pangea. And after that, he kind of disappears for a while. The next time he's heard from is on a Herbie Hancock album from 1983, Future Shock, the one with Rocket on it. And I haven't been able to find much information about Pete Cozy over the years, just because there's not a lot out there, but I have heard some things. He was kind of a mad scientist when it came to his approach to the guitar. Not only did he use a bunch of pedals, a bunch of effects, and alternate tunings for every single song, but he also would do things like change the string order. A lot of what he did went on to inspire some future more adventurous guitarists like, you know, Fred Frith, Henry Kaiser, Vernon Reed. Definitely listen to Agartha and Pangea. I love them. But not until you're ready. Make sure you've got a couple hours free, a nice cozy room, and a good pair of headphones. I also really like his contribution to a Miles Davis tribute album that came out like 20 years ago or so. It's called Miles from India, where he appears on the song Miles Runs the Voodoo Down in a band that includes Lenny White and Michael Henderson. Pete Cozy. Mid to late 80s was a great time to be learning guitar, especially if you were into the shredders. Unfortunately, I wasn't. I was too caught up in trying to figure out blues and jazz things to get too much into things like Surfing with the Alien or Flex Abel. But if what I was hearing was weird sounding or jazzy sounding enough, then there were some exceptions. I still occasionally lament the fact that I learned how to play finger style instead of with a pick. Oh well. Anyway, my connection to the jazz and weirder sounding stuff is kind of how I got introduced to Tony McAlpine. See, I was hanging with a friend one day,
And I played for him my cassette copy of Tones by Eric Johnson. And after we finished listening to that, he put on Maximum Security by Tony McAlpine. And what I remember is being taken in by the lyricism of his playing, not to mention the chops, especially on the song Tears of the Sahara. My friend was especially excited to play me the Chopin piano piece that he plays on there, because my friend was really into the whole classical metal overlap at the time. At the time, his greatest ambition was to try to learn how to play D by Randy Rhoads on guitar. And because of that interaction, because I had that positive experience of listening to Tony McAlpine with my friend, it helped me to expand my circle a little bit. It helped me to get to a place where later on I could hear some artists that then became very important to me. It helped me grow. And if that was the whole story, that would be enough. If all that Tony McAlpine was able to do for me was to help me grow my circle, expand my ears, he'd still be important to me. But as I was putting this list together, my friend Eric Sanders gave me some recommendations. And over the past 3 or 4 weeks, I've become more acquainted with some more of his albums. For me, there will always be a nostalgia associated with Tears of Sahara. So if you don't know that, listen to it. It's very nice. Beyond that, over the past few weeks, I've gotten familiar with his first album, Edge of Insanity, and with his 2001 release, Chromaticity. And they're both fabulous. Spin those as well. Plus, all three have Steve Smith on drums. Tony McAlpine. I've never been that much of a metalhead. Even as my appreciation for the musicianship has grown over the years, it's never been music that I've sought out. Although, to be honest, it wouldn't take much to convert me. There's a lot to like. But even if I never fully go that route, there are a handful of albums in the genre that I listen to pretty regularly. And chief among them is Weightless by Animals as Leaders. And I don't know that I ever would have gotten into them or even heard about them if not for the fact that their guitarist, Tosin Abasi, is a graduate of the Atlanta Institute of Music, where my friend Eric Sanders teaches. And within just a year or two of him graduating from AIM, I started seeing his name everywhere. Guitar Player Magazine, Signature Instruments, his own instrument company, he's killing it. What I love about the music of Animals as Leaders is through all the insanely complex aspects of their music, the rhythmic groupings, the strange harmonics of the chord structures, the insanely fast passages, it all still feels musical. It's music you can hum, not precisely in the same way as complicated groups like Return to Forever or Dixie Dregs are also very musical, but very close. It's music that gets stuck in your head. Well, my head anyway. There's a lot more room up there than most heads, I suppose. But what I love about Tosin Abasi's guitar playing is a lot like what I love about Steve Morse's guitar playing. There's a versatility to both of them. They can play over a wide series of timbres, a wide series of harmonic approaches, a wide series of techniques, but it's never not them. And even if Gent is 1,000 miles from anything that you're interested in listening to, just try out the last song off of Weightless. It's called David. It's a pretty little guitar piece. There's no big screaming anything about it. And if you like that, then try your hand at the rest of the album. I think you might be surprised. And if you're okay with Weightless, I also really love their next album, The Joy of Motion. Tosin Abasi.
During the few moments that we have left, we want to talk right down to earth in a language that everybody here can easily understand. There are quite a few guitarists out there that have influenced the way that I play, but there's only a select few that have influenced the way that I think. Much of how I think about the role of guitar in a group setting, about the relationships, of the tensions created between speed, tone, harmonic diatonic structures, and, you know, playing out. A lot of the way that I think about those aspects of music, I learned from Vernon Reid. And because when it comes to the music of Living Color, it would be disingenuous to separate the music from the message, I also have to say that a good amount of how I think about things like gentrification, politics of language, latent biases. Living Color came at the absolute perfect time in my life. I graduated basically 1 month after the release of Vivid. The riffs were the right blend of noisy and catchy. The grooves were both hard and could be funky. The musicianship was off the charts. Every aspect of the music showed both heart and intelligence. I kind of fetishized that album for the next couple of years. Same for the next two releases, Time's Up and Stain, and their 1991 video release, Time Tunnel. And I kind of have to say it makes me smile that my college-age kid, Astrid, one of their favorite albums is Time's Up as well. And I haven't even talked about the fact that Vernon Reid has played with everyone from B.B. King to Carlos Santana to Mick Jagger to Public Enemy. For recommendations, I have to start with Love Rears Its Ugly Head from Time's Up for Astrid. From there, if you haven't heard Living Colors 2009 release, Burned Bridges, check that one out. There's a lot of sonic experimentation going on out there. Also, he did a tribute project called Spectrum Road, which was a tribute to Tony Williams' Lifetime with John Medeski, Jack Bruce, and Cindy Blackman. I really like that one a lot. Vernon Reid. It's not every day that a guitarist comes along that invents an entirely new way to play the instrument. For a long time, I only knew Tom Morello as the guy from Rage Against the Machine. But as with all things metal and hard rock, my friend Eric hip me to the bigger truth and introduced me first to Audioslave. But the turning point for me with Tom Morello was hearing him speak and reading his writing, believe it or not. Turns out I prize intelligence in my music. And I was surprised by learning some of the things that I learned about Tom Morello's career. He was born in New York, moved to Libertyville, Illinois when he was young, graduated with honors, got a degree from Harvard, moved to LA, and his first job in LA was as an exotic dancer. Got his first touring and recording band together, Lock Up, and then from there to Rage Against the Machine, and then from there to Audioslave, and then from there to The Night Watchman, Prophets of Rage, among many others. But did you know that he played with Bruce Springsteen in the E Street Band? He was on the album Wrecking Ball and the accompanying tour. Tom Morello was able to bring together technique and technology in a way that few guitarists ever have. You know, he can do the traditional role of a hard rock and, you know, hardcore guitarist, play the gallop and the riffs, but he also was able to do things like make his guitar sound as if it was a DJ on turntables. And that's more important than you might think. The whole idea of turning a melodic instrument into a rhythmic instrument, subverting the role of the melody and the rhythms, that's a big aspect in modern music that I think a lot of people overlook, and Tom Morello does it better than anyone. I'm still pretty new to a lot of Tom Morello's catalog, so I'm certain that there are some things that I'm missing here, but for my recommendations, Know Your Enemy from the first Rage Against the Machine album. I really love the solo on that. Drown Me Slowly by Audioslave uses a bunch of his techniques. And if you can find the Guitar Fury remix of the song Promenade from Street Sweeper Social Club, that one is a masterclass in the use of the whammy pedal. Tom Morello. May you never hear surf music again. Of all the 56 guitarists that I talked about over this entire month, I think if there's one that everyone saw coming, it's James Marshall Hendrix. And for those of you that don't know or maybe never knew, the reason why Jimmy utters those words during Third Stone from the Sun, may you never hear surf music again, is because in 1967, when he recorded that, the guitar heroes of the day were surf players like Dick Dale. He was trying to move the guitar away from clean, bright, shiny surf pop to the more psychedelic acid rock. So may you never hear surf music again. But beyond that, what am I going to tell you about Jimi Hendrix that you don't already know? He changed the way the guitar is played. He's one of maybe three musicians in the history of rock and roll that fundamentally changed the way that the genre is executed. I can tell you a funny story that's tangential to Jimi Hendrix, I suppose. You know Martin Mull? Fernwood Tonight? Soap? He's a guitar player as well. And a really good one. In fact, he was doing session work in and around the Village in New York in the mid-60s, but he wanted very much to go to art school. So when he was invited to move overseas to join this trio that was starting up, he decided he would rather spend time studying art than join this band that was just now coming together over in London. And that's why the Jimi Hendrix Experience is a trio and not a quartet. The album of Jimi Hendrix I probably have listened to most often is Axis Bold as Love. I really like that one a lot. The album that I find is closest to my heart
is Electric Ladyland, especially because of the songwriting. I think my favorite Jimi Hendrix composition of all time is Burning of the Midnight Lamp from Electric Ladyland. But having said all that, the older I've gotten and the more Hendrix I've listened to, the more I've come to appreciate Band of Gypsies. That live performance that was captured for that album is just amazing. Jimi Hendrix, y'all. I was dreaming when I wrote this. Forgive me if it goes astray. This one snuck up on me. I'd always been a fan of Prince's music in one form or another, starting with his release Purple Rain. That's when I really got plugged into what he was doing. But him as a guitarist, it's kind of an odd thing. Because when I would listen to Prince albums as a kid, I would hear these songs and they would have these beautiful synth lines and they'd have this high energy, and every once in a while there'd be this great screaming guitar solo. And I never thought to look into who it might have been. But slowly it began to dawn on me, wait a minute, if he's the one recording everything on some of these albums, like Sign of the Times, then it's gotta be him playing the guitar. And can you think of one other person who can play the guitar that well that that's not primarily what they're known for? It's crazy, right? But in retrospect, it's kind of a Prince kind of a move, right? I mean, yeah, on this song, it's just gonna be a beat and a bass and some vocals. And on this song, we'll add some synth. Oh, and also on this song, I'm gonna blow your freaking head off with this Telecaster. And then on this next song, we'll bring the girls in to sing some backup. I mean, we've all seen the video of him playing the Telecaster on stage with 1,000 of the most talented musicians of all time playing While My Guitar Gently Weeps, and he blows every single one of them off the stage. He's amazing. But if you're like I used to be and hadn't really dug into Prince's music, specifically looking for the good guitar stuff, let me cue you in on a few that I found that I really dig. The last song on his very first album, For You, is called I'm Yours, and it killed. And on his second album, the self-titled album, just called Prince, there's a song called Bambi, which has got one of the greasiest, glammiest, hardest riffs you've ever heard. The solo in it's pretty damn cool as well. Prince Rogers Nelson, aka the artist, aka the kid, aka Prince. Never forget, rock and roll was invented by a black woman. Chuck Berry released his first single in 1955. Little Richard released his first in 1951. But Sister Rosetta Tharpe, 1938, a single called Rock Me. But it was her 1944 single recorded for Decca Records, a full decade before what most people think of as the start of rock and roll, that brought her to national attention. In that single, Sister Rosetta Tharpe fused the structure, the guitar stylings of blues, with the energy and the harmonies of gospel, and recorded Strange Things Happening Every Day, the first gospel song to chart on the R&B charts at number 2. And on that single, the first thing you hear is Sister Rosetta Tharpe's guitar. But don't take my word for it. Chuck Berry, Elvis Presley, Jerry Lee Lewis, they're all on record as being influenced by Sister Rosetta Tharpe. In 1947, when she was playing a concert at the Macon City Auditorium, she invited young Richard Penniman up on stage after hearing him sing the previous day. That became Little Richard's first public appearance outside a church. And here's what Bob Dylan had to say about her. Sister Rosetta Tharpe was anything but ordinary and plain. She was a big, good-looking woman, and divine, not to mention sublime and splendid. She was a powerful force of nature, a guitar-playing, singing evangelist. So dig back into her early sides. Rock Me, That's All, Strange Things Happening Every Day, all killer, but also Jericho from her 1956 album Gospel Train. Ladies and gentlemen, Sister Rosetta Tharpe. In 2015, I was invited for the first time to participate in Roots Rock Revival, the music camp that my father started up in the Catskills along with Othiel Burbridge, Cody Dickinson, and Luther Dickinson. One of the artists on the roster that year was saxophone legend Bill Evans, someone whose work I've admired for decades. I really wanted to make a good impression. In the jams on that first night at the Roadhouse, the band was me, Butch, Othiel, Luther, Bill, keyboardist Craig Keel, I think the second drummer might have been Rory Walsh, and a 12-year-old camp attendee named Brandon Niederauer. Someone called Stormy Monday, we started it up,
And I think that I have played as well as I ever have. I'm 100% proud of what I played that night and how I represented myself. But Brandon took the next solo, and by the time he was done, there was nothing else I could do but take off my guitar and bow. There's video of it if you want to see. And I had been hearing for months about this young prodigy, right? I have a friend in New Orleans named Sydney Smith, a photographer, who had been raving about Brandon for a long time. But there's a difference between a great young guitarist and a great guitarist. And even from a young age, Brandon was a great guitarist. Brandon got his professional start performing in the cast of School of Rock, the Andrew Lloyd Webber Broadway musical. He's since been on The Ellen Show, Late Show with Stephen Colbert. He's been on The View. He's performed live with everyone from Stevie Nicks to The Scorpions. Plus, he has his own signature guitar from D'Angelico. And we're now at the point where we're starting to get some of his studio recordings out into the world, especially the recordings that he's made with other artists. There's a group called Ghost Note, which is a collaboration between two of the folks from Snarky Puppy. Really great album called Swagism from 2018. Brandon plays on the tune Smack 'Em. And in 2020, Bootsy Collins released an album called The Power of One. And Brandon is on the track called Jam On, along with Snoop Dogg. Brandon Niederauer.